speak at Strauss's birthday conference, and as far as I understand, well, it's your birthday. So happy birthday. Unfortunately, I realized that at least a big part of the talk Russ has already heard. So I thought that I should tell at least something new to Russ. And I decided to tell about the first time I met Russ. And actually, this is a factual proof of how much I have always appreciated his mathematics. So it was when I was a beginning PhD student, and I was thinking about random walks and groups, and there was this question that was fashionable at that time, asked by Sarnak, whether you can say something about the spectral radius and the green function of the random walk on a regular hyperbolic tessellation, the Cayley graph of the surface group, for example. And I was trying to compute the spectral radius. Actually, it's still open, and last year I heard two talks of Gromov about that, so apparently it's again on a mode. And I think my PhD advisor, Pierre Delahart, he thought that it was maybe too addictive, so he sent me off to New York to visit Joseph Dozyuk with the idea that maybe I learned something new. So I got to New York and was at the Graduate Center, which is at the heart of Manhattan. I was happy not only to take advantage of mathematics, but also, you know, to see other things, and in particular, I wanted to go to the Metropolitan Opera. And I chose a date where, when they were giving these Augenflöten, and I knew that the tickets were very expensive, but if you go there 1 hour before the performance, you can get a ticket to walk in for, I don't know, $20. So I was planning to do that, but then you have to go there, I don't know, something like 7 p.m., you have to be there. And then the same day, all of a sudden, they tell me at the Graduate Center that an extra talk has been planned, an impromptu talk, but by Russ Lyons, about random walks on groups. At 6 p.m. And so I had a choice. Either Russ's talk or Mozart, and I chose the talk. So I went to the talk, and I still remember what it was about. It was about the short paper that you have in Compte Rendu, random walks on groups. So it's a very nice result. If you have a finely generated group, and you run a random walk with a radial drift, so a homesick parameter, then the transition between transience and recurrence is given by the rate of exponential growth of the group. So, incidentally, I also caught the opera later that night by jumping from the Graduate Center to the Metropolitan, but initially I preferred to go to the talk. Okay, so the talk was about growth in groups and random walks, and so what I'm going to tell today is also roughly can be put into the same general topic. So I will tell you some things about groups of intermediate growth, and because this is a probability conference, I will briefly reminding what it means. So we talk about finitely generated groups, and so G is a group and S is a finite subset such that every element can be written as a product of these generators and their inverses, and as Gromov teaches us, every finitely generated group has to be looked at as a metric space. So you think about the Cayley graph with the graph metric associated to the choice of your generators. And you can count the number of elements in the ball of radius R. And the asymptotics of this sequence is what is called the growth of the group. It doesn't depend on the choice of the generators. So it can be at most exponential. And the examples of groups of exponential growth are free groups, hyperbolic groups, laplacians, many other groups that you know. And polynomial growth, on the other hand, this is, by Gromov's theorem, exactly virtual and important groups. And so, for some time, the question was open whether there is something in between exponential and polynomial, so super polynomial but sub-exponential. And now there is a whole world of those monsters, but much loved by their creators. And the first of them was Grigorchuk, who around 1980 proved the first example of a group of intermediate growth, they are called, so strictly between polynomial and exponential. And I will start by just defining you the first example of a group of intermediate growth, because I think that by now it's like a nice thing to know. It's like the lamplighter, you hear about it all the time, and eventually you know what it is. So this first Grigorchuk group also, it's very easy to define. So the origin of these monsters are automorphisms of rooted trees. So we'll start with just the binary tree. And our group will be a finitely generated subgroup in the group of full automorphisms of this tree. So this is the root. And of course, if we talk about automorphisms, every automorphism has to preserve the root. So then it has to preserve the distance to the root. So what it does, it actually acts on every level by commuting the vertices of the level. So okay, you take an automorphism, you look at what it does at the root. It can either do nothing or switch the two branches. Then you look what it does at each branch. But each branch is again isomorphic to the whole binary tree. So again, it's the same. So either you put an epsilon, and then it means that there is a switch, or you put nothing, then it means that doesn't switch the two branches. And you do that at each vertex. This gives you sort of a portrait of an element, and this is how you can describe automorphisms of the binary tree. So now I define the group. So it will be defined by generated by four automorphisms. So A is just the switch at the root. So you switch the two branches and then you do nothing, so I don't draw anything below. And B, C, and D, they have not finitely but infinitely supported portraits, but they are so-called spinal automorphisms in the sense that all the activity happens along the infinite line, the infinite ray, one infinity. So, of course, the binary tree, this is 0, 0, 0, 1, and so on. So the vertices are binary verbs. And then we also have the boundary, dt, which are infinite infinite binary verbs. So this is the boundary point 1 infinity. So let me draw A again. This is my generator A. And these are B, C, and D. And they are defined as follows. So B does nothing at the root, does epsilon here. So B does epsilon, epsilon, and then nothing, and then epsilon, epsilon, nothing, and so on. So this means when I draw nothing below, it means that after that there are only trivial action. And C will do epsilon, nothing, epsilon, epsilon, nothing, epsilon, and so on. And D will do the third possible thing, so nothing, epsilon, epsilon, nothing, epsilon, epsilon, and so on. So is this clear?
So period 3 went along the line.
Yes, yes.
All of period 3 and one of the three is missing.
Yes. Okay, so and these four automorphisms define a subgroup, and this is the first example of a group of intermediate growth. Okay, I will tell you a little bit more. So first of all, you may wonder why these four automorphisms, and of course, in fact, we should define not one group, but an uncountable family of groups. So there is an immediate an idea that you can maybe do something similar, but not exactly this. So let us look at what B, C, and D do together at each level. And there are three possibilities. Either this is epsilon, epsilon, nothing, or epsilon, nothing, epsilon, or nothing, epsilon, epsilon. And of course, you can mix those. So let us call this 0, 1, and 2. And then you see that if you take 0, 1, and 2 as an alphabet, then for any omega in A to N, omega 0, omega 1, omega 2, and so on, you can get G omega by just placing the corresponding configurations at level 0, level 1, level 2, and so on of the tree. So the group that is depicted here, so first Grigorchuk's group, is G 0, 1, 2 in the period. So we have 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2. But then you can also have 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, and so on. So G constant is just the infinite dihedral group. This is too simple. So the free product of two cyclic groups of order 2. But starting from non-constant sequences, it becomes interesting. So what we wanted to prove was the following. So for every omega not eventually constant, G omega is of intermediate growth, so strictly between polynomial and exponential. And two, if omega contains all three letters, then G omega is an infinite torsion group. So it means that it's an infinite finitely generated group such that all the elements have finite order. So this is also a monster type group. It was for a long time open question whether such groups exist. This is known as the Pearnside problem. But solutions have been known before this. It was not the first, but still it's interesting to get such examples. Yes?
Are you considering only periodic omega?
No.
So if it's not periodic, is this a finitely generated group?
Yes, it's always co-generated. So you just take the same. You have B, C, and D always, but they will correspond to different omega, so you will just have different sequence of epsilons and free spots according to the sequence. Okay. But the number of generators and even the shape of the generators do not change. So the only thing that changes is the exact configuration of the action.
And is there some control how many relations you get in different cases?
Okay, so except for the case of the trivial case of the infinite dihedral group, all the groups are not finitely represented, so it's not possible to put a finite number of relations on these four generators in order to describe the group. But there are two of those which are special. So it is the first Grigorchuk group and also the one which corresponds to the sequence 0, 1 in the period, which is often known as Grigorchuk-Escher group because Anna Escher described this growth. And in fact, it's interesting because Grigorchuk's group grows in between two exponentials, e to the alpha and e to the beta, with certain values of alpha and beta, which are strictly less than 1. And this group grows quicker than any e to the alpha with alpha less than 1. So it's essentially a different type of growth, but still sub-exponential. And these groups are the only examples in this uncountable family of what is called self-similar groups. And, these are particularly nice examples, but the only thing that I should say about them here, because I don't really have time, is that they are not finitely presented, but they have a nice type of presentation, which involves a substitution that I will use later, so I'm going to give you this presentation for Grigorchuk group. So, so we have four generators, which are all evolutions. Then we have the fact that the product of B, C, and D is equal to 1, which is very easy to compute. And those are all the relations which are kind of obvious. And then there are two infinite families of relations. Well, I'm writing the exact shape, but in fact it's not so important what are the words that are in parentheses here. What is important that sigma to the k are the iterations of a single substitution, which is very simple. And which turns out to be crucial for the description of the group. So this is already a very nice fact. You cannot give a finite presentation, but you can give such a recursive presentation with the help of a substitution. And this is a consequence of the fact that these groups correspond to sequences which are periodic, and moreover, in the period you have just one, each letter appearing just once. So these are the only ones that can appear with this alphabet. Okay, so why have we taken just these four generators? So this question has been asked, I guess, by many people. And in fact, this is part of a bigger construction. So I'm going to tell you about a natural generalization of this. But then I will concentrate maybe on these examples, mostly. So actually, I reread the invitation letter to this conference this morning. And it said literally the following. According to Russ's taste, we ask you maybe to concentrate more on interesting ideas and methods rather than giving the results that you can obtain in full generality. So I'm going to mention the generalization because it's interesting and shows some new behavior, but then I will concentrate on the easiest example. Yes?
Do I understand correctly that D is equal to BC, so you only add it for symmetry that you don't really need?
Exactly. So this is written here. BCD is equal to 1. And this is actually also, thank you, this is an important observation that in fact this group is 3 generated. So later on I'm going to talk about the spectra of random walks on kinegraphs of this group, and it is interesting that there is a huge difference between this very specific generating set and the minimal generating set when you just have the minimal number 3 generators.
You just define sigma on the letters, you define it on the word just by homomorphism or something like that? Because
so this is a substitution, so yeah, then you can, yeah, you can iterate it just by, yeah. Okay, so this alphabet, just 0, 1, 2, this is not very satisfactory. It's not clear why you should take just 0, 1, 2. So in fact, you should think about this in this way. So A clearly generates the cyclic group of order 2, and B, C, and D together with 1, they form the group with 4 elements, because BCD is equal to 1, and this is the direct product of C2 and C2. So you should think about this alphabet as all possible epimorphisms from, let's call this B, capital B, from capital B to A.
I always wondered what 0, 1, 2 were.
Yeah, so I'm about to explain it. So more generally, for every D, which is the degree of the tree, so D equals to 2, bigger equal than 2, and for every M, bigger equal than 1, you can consider the alphabet A, D, M, which will be the epimorphisms from C, D to the power M, direct power, so let me write C, D cross C, D, M times, to C, D. And then for every omega in A, B, M to N, consider the group G omega, which will be defined by A, and the group B omega, where B is this CD cross CD. And A will be again, so now we have our tree of degree D. So we have maybe more branches here. This is the root. And A just adds cyclically. So this is A, which generates the cyclic group of order D. So you just permute the branches cyclically at the first level and you don't do anything else. And then the elements of B omega are just elements of B, but you take omega 0 of B, so let's say B is B1, B2, B to the power, B, B to the M, and you take omega 0 of B1, omega 1 of B1, and so on, and here you will have omega 0 of B2, omega 1 of B2, and so on. So you see the epimorphisms give you the alphabet, and then for every sequence, infinite sequence in this alphabet, you read your sequence, omega 0, omega 1, omega 2, and so on. And the first letter, the 0 letter, gives you the action of all the generators, non-trivial generators, except A, on the first level, on the 0th level of the tree, just by projecting the corresponding element of the group capital B by the epimorphism omega 0, then you project by omega 1, this gives you the action on the first level of the tree, omega 2 describes the action on the second level of the tree, and so on. Exactly as it happened here. obtain. So this defines a whole bunch of groups. So it's a countable family for every D, for every M, of uncountable families of groups. Because for every D and every M, you get an uncountable family of sequences, and so uncountable family of groups. And you can show that except for trivial permutations of the letters, they are all different. So there is an isomorphism problem which can be solved.
And is it crucial that locally the permutations are cyclic?
Okay, so I'm sticking to the instruction to not to give it full generality. So actually, Bartolti and Suni wrote a paper about what they call spinal groups, and there you can do whatever you want here, and you generalize also the... You can put many more stuff in with the whole idea that you have this spinal action, but I'm not going to talk about it, but you can do that, yeah. But the problem is that more general the family is, less things you can say about it, so you have to find some balance between what you do. Anyway, just to give you an idea, so I told you that for the binary tree, if you take M equal to 1, so the constant sequence, then you just get the infinite dihedral group. So now I'm going to tell you that if you take D equal to 3 and the constant sequence, then you get a group which already has a name. It's called Fabrikovsky-Gupta group. And it is a group of intermediate growth, very complicated, very few things are known about it, and it's a self-similar group which corresponds to some nice fractal, but it's not even a polynomial Julia set, but a rational function Julia set, so it's infinitely more complicated than the infinite dihedral group. So this shows that actually there is some qualitative difference when you go from the groups acting on the binary tree to the groups acting on trees of higher degree. So let me maybe put this down, because this is an example that I'm going to go back to. So G3 and 0 infinity, so M equal to 1. This is Fabrikovsky-Gupta group of intermediate growth. So some of these groups had names because at the initial stage of the theory, it was very difficult to get new examples of groups of intermediate growth. So each time that there was one, it got a name. So now we have this huge family, I mean, countable number of uncountable families. And there is this is an open question whether all of them are of intermediate growth. So Grigorchuk showed that the ones that act on the binary tree and correspond to M equal to 2 are all of intermediate growth. This is his initial theorem. You can also prove this for all other values of M. But for ternary or higher degree tree, this is an open question. And till very recently, the only example for which the intermediate growth was known was this one, plus groups which are infinite torsion. And this is a this is an important still an infinite family of groups, but if you consider all the sequences in the alphabet, this corresponds to a subset of measure zero. So recently, a student of mine, Dominique Franqueur, proved that for d equal to 3, a bigger subset, which corresponds to a subset of sequences of measure 1, all are of intermediate growth, but still, this is only true for d equal to 3, and so in general, this remains a and over the growth of these groups remains an open question. But people believe that here you can find many more examples of group of intermediate growth. Okay, so now I would like to tell you about a method to study these groups. And this is the method is to go to symbolic to associate an interesting action and to study this action by the means of symbolic dynamics. So I will describe the action, and then after that, the last part, it will be the applications of this method to computation of spectra for the random walks. Okay, so let me just call my group G, and it can be any of those groups. And it acts by automorphisms on the tree. And so you can extend this extension by continuity, and then it will also act by homeomorphisms on the boundary of the tree. So the infinite words in your alphabet with D letters. So we have our boundary of the tree. Here we pick a point, let's call it psi. And then for psi, you can correspond with the orbital graph of the action. So it's something which is sometimes called Schreier graph. Maybe you don't know this terminology, but it's not very complicated. So the vertices are just the orbit. So it's orbital graph. The points of the orbit of psi. So vertices, this is g times psi. And then you put the edges when you can go from one point to the other by multiplying by a generator. So this corresponds to the group and the generating set. Okay? So the group itself, you know, is a group of intermediate growth. It has a very messy Kinner graph. And so people were excited when they realized that for this boundary action, the graphs are very simple. So for Grigorchuk group, if you take one infinity, you can just draw it and understand what it is. And it is a graph of this shape. So you have A as a label here. So these graphs are labeled by generators. And you have B, C, D. And here you have D. And here you have C. And so on. And there is some distribution of generators on the loops. And they determine what happens on the double edges. And if you take psi, which is not a boundary of the interval, then you will get a similar thing, but two-ended. So A, and then B, C, and D distributed some way there. So maybe as a motivating question, it's easy to study the simple random walk on such a graph. It's easy to study the simple random walk on such a graph because if the weights of your generators are all the same, then this just amounts to a random walk on the infinite dihedral group, and you can just do it by harmonic analysis. So early on, Grigorchuk and Bartoldi computed the spectrum of the simple random walk on this graph by a more complicated method, though, but still. And it turns out to be a union of two intervals. I will write it down later. And that's the question, what happens if the random walk is non-isotropic? So if the weights of generators B, C, and D are all different, then the distribution of those B, C, and D along this pi infinite line is completely chaotic, because you don't really understand what is the labeling of this Schreier graph. You only know that they are all the same geometrically. And so how to say something about this case. So this was the motivating question. They asked it in the year 2000. And so recently, in a joint work with Daniel Lenz and again Grigorchuk, we found, and I hope, an elegant way to answer this question and also to do more things. So for that, we are going to, yes, and also as an advertisement, actually knowing the spectrum of the random walk on this graph helps to say something about the spectrum of the Kinner graph, it turns out. Even though this is also surprising because this is just a line, so it's of particular linear growth, and it is seems very different from the Kinner graph. So this is an example of a totally non-free action in Versch's terminology, which means that you have quotient out a lot from the group to get here. But still, it turns out that this is quite a useful tool. Okay, to make it really useful, we have to replace the action on the boundary of the tree by a slightly different action in the spirit of a paper of Eli Glasner and Benji Weiss. So we would like to have a... this is already a minimal action, which is nice. So gx on dt is minimal, because it's transitive on each level. But it is not invariant under a natural equivalence relation, which is preservance of the root. When you act on rooted graphs, you want the root to be preserved. And so let me explain this. So the aim is to construct an interesting action. So so we have a map that let us call it Shire, from the boundary of the tree to the space of all rooted grass, which are labeled by the generators of the group G. So all grass, rooted grass, that can be labeled as Shire grass of the group G. Okay? And then G acts on this space by the change of the root. So alternatively, you can think about the action of the group on the space of all its subgroups, and there this action corresponds to the action by conjugation. This is a very natural so-called adjoint action. Every group acts on the space of all its subgroups by conjugation. And when you replace subgroups by the Shire graphs, then this becomes the action by the change of the root. Okay, I want to work with graphs, so I immediately consider this this thing here. So now we also have G which acts on dt, as explained before. And the nice thing here that this map is injective in our case. Exactly because the action is totally non-free, so this is an algebraic property of the group, that all the point stabilizers are all different, and so this implies that this map is injective. But it is not continuous. This is not so nice. But it is continuous on a big subset. So in here, there is, I don't know, x0, the set of continuity points.
Can you explain again why it is?
Why it is injective? Or what?
Yeah.
So it's injective. This is the consequence of the fact that the group is branch. Okay, I really can't explain that, but I can explain it later. So it basically means that your action doesn't die out, so it branches off as far away as you want in the tree. Okay, so the set of continuity points is dense G delta set. And so what you do, you take the image of this set of continuity points inside the space of rooted grass, and you take the closure. And this is a minimal invariant subsystem for the action of G on the whole space of Shire graphs. So we started with a minimal action, and we kind of modeled it here. We found its image in the space for the action of the G on the space of all rooted labeled graphs. And so this space is, let's call it nice S of G dt. So we can call it the Shire space and the Shire action. So now, instead of considering the action of G on the boundary, we'd rather consider the action of G on this nice space, which is invariant under the change of the root. Okay, so here is the main technical result, which actually has been found more or less at the same time in different shape by different people. So by Marte Born, then in our joint paper with Grigorchuk and Glantz, and also later still in a different shape by Nekrashevich. So this works for, in our version, it works for all groups acting on the binary tree for all values of M. So for all omega, omega acts on a subshift sigma. With the same orbits as the shift, and there exists a continuous equivariant 2-to-1 subjection from the subshift to the space of Schreier graphs of the group. A continuous 2-to-1 subjection, which is equivariant, yes. So this means that basically the action of the group on a space of Schreier graphs can be viewed up to this 2-1 factor as a subshift over a finite alphabet. And this turns out to be a very useful fact. It has many different consequences. In particular, this allows you to embed this group into the topological full group of this minimal shift. So this is a minimal subshift. And there are other consequences of that, but I will concentrate on the spectral consequences, because it turns out that in many examples, this subshift is a low complexity subshift, and we can use the theory, the spectral theory of Schrödinger operators on low complexity subshifts in order to deduce things about the spectra of Laplacians on our Schreier graphs. And this is something that we wanted to do.
Just to make sure, there's no connection between the G omega action and the Z action on sigma omega, right?
They are the same orbits.
Right, but that's it.
That's it, yeah. Yes, the group, the group itself, of course, I mean, well, what type of connection you would want to have?
It just seems like an unnatural construction that there would be a subshift, when it's a G omega action.
So it means that you can make your group act locally as the shift. So it can be embedded into the topological full group of this subshift.
We can act locally as the shift.
So it means that...
Leaf-wise,
that's it. But it still turns out to be quite useful. So corollary, so again for D equal to 2, the Markov operators for a nearest neighbor random walk on an orbital graph gamma of G is unitarily equivalent omega, so this is again for any omega, to the Schrödinger operator on the subshift sigma omega. So let me write it down. Is the Jacobi matrix with some function on the diagonal and some function on the main diagonal and the off main diagonals. So it is given for every psi in the subshift, and when you apply it to an L2 function, it acts like this. So it's f t n minus 1 psi u n minus 1 plus f d to the n psi u n plus 1 plus what happens at the main diagonal t to the n psi u of n. And u is an alpha function of d. Okay, so this corresponds to the Jacobi matrices like that.
So what's t sub psi?
Sorry?
What is t
this
sub
is the shift. So subshift that I denote by capital T.
Oh, let's see if I can.
This is the off diagonal, this is the main diagonal.
Do you require anything from f and g?
Sorry?
F and g are any functions.
So we are given our Markov operator on such a graph. So it means that we have some probabilities assigned to A, B, C, and D. And there is just the nearest neighbor random walk that walks along this line, and there is the transition probability matrix. And F and G are basically determined by the values of probabilities that you define on A, B, C, and D. So it's not exactly the same, but there are some linear combination of those weights.
Okay. But they depend on only a finite number of coordinates? F and G?
Yes.
They're functions of finite numbers.
They are, no, so they are with the infinite support.
Ah.
So the diagonals are, the functions f and g are of infinite support, yeah. So I don't know what you mean, they depend on all the time.
C is an infinite sequence. It's an element in the symbolic shift, right?
Yes, exactly.
So f and g,
function
of c.
No, they don't depend only on finite. It's completely, it really depends on the whole sequence.
Okay, because you said it depended on the probabilities, it wasn't clear.
No, but on the probabilities, I mean the values that f and g can take, there are only finitely many values. But how these values are distributed along the diagonal, this really depends on the whole sequence. Yes?
Does Catani theory play a role now?
Yes, so this does play a role. But so we don't really use the whole machinery because there have been results that were already here before us. So we use the theorem by Damanik and Lenz. So that's how our collaboration started. But I think the proof uses Cotani in an essential way. It turns out that for the first big virtual group and some other sequences omega, the subshift sigma is what is called linear repetitive. This means, so this is a minimal subshift. It means that if you take this word, finite word, you can find it in a sufficiently big subword of any sequence. And linear repetitive means that the size of the word where you're going to find it will linearly depend on the size of the word you started with. So this is kind of a bound on the complexity of the subshift. This is an example of a low complexity subshift. And for such subshifts, Damanik and Lenz can prove the qualitative description of the spectrum. So let me say it this way. So the theorem says that if f and g are periodic, then the spectrum of the Schrödinger operator will be a union of intervals. And if it's non-periodic, then it will be a Cantor set on which I measure zero. And so when we translate this via our corollary to the result about the random walks of the Schreier graphs, this gives you that the spectrum of the isotropic random walk on the Schreier graph, on any Schreier graph, so actually it doesn't depend on the particular graph, and anisotropic, which means that probability of B, probability of C, and probability of D are not all the same. you that the spectrum in the counterset of the wave measure zero.
But when it says if it's for the interval, it's not absolutely continuous, is it?
So in this case, it is in fact absolutely continuous for the interval.
So the process is deterministic.
So, yes, in this case it's an absolutely continuous measure. Here it is singular, and then one can also deduce the absence of eigenvalues almost surely for the points in this space.
But absolute continuity requires, if I'm not mistaken, the process to be deterministic under shield.
So, in fact, the fact that here it is absolutely continuous, this is something that we know de facto. We can just compute the spectral measure by finite approximation. So here we know the spectral measure, we can compute it, and we know the density. So I actually don't know whether this requires something. Presumably it does, but this is something that you can compute explicitly on the graph, so you don't need really to go to the other side for that in our situation. Okay, so my time is almost over. So let me tell you that another corollary obtained in a joint work with Grigorchuk and my PhD student Aitor Teres is that actually the spectrum of the isotropic random walk, so isotropic, which is minus 1 to 2 to the m minus 1, 0, and 1 minus 1 over 2 to the m minus 1, 1. So when m goes to infinity, this concentrates really to two points, 0 and 1. And interesting, so actually this is a theorem, coincides with the spectrum of the simple random walk on the Kelly graph. So this is another elegant argument based on an idea of perturbative core that I would have liked to tell about, but I cannot, but this is a very nice fact. So in particular, we have uncountable family of groups. So all of them have the same spectrum of this type. So in general, it's quite rare to know exactly the spectrum of the random walk on a Kelly graph. So we like this. And the very final sentence is that now, with two young people who are not afraid of making messy computations, we are working on the case of ternary tree. So this Gupta-Fabrikowski group of intermediate growth. And here we have proved that the spectrum, so the Schreier graph, it is not linear anymore. It is something like that. It is a graph of non-integer polynomial growth, which is still subquadratic, but so it is not quasi-isometric to a line. And we were able also to find the subshift of low complexity that encodes the space of Schreier graphs for these groups, but the subshift is not with respect to the action of Z, or in fact in this case it was not the action of Z but of infinite dihedral group. But here it is the subshift of the finite alphabet on ternary tree, and the group which adds is C3, free product with C3. So it's kind of a higher dimensional subshift. And I have no idea whether someone has looked at Schrödinger operators of higher dimensional subshifts of low complexity. So this is something that we would need in order to apply the same method in this case. But meanwhile, by a pure combinatorial computation, we were able to determine the spectral type of the isotropic random walk on these Schreier graphs, and it turns out that this is a counterset of Lebesgue measure zero. So this is again in contrast with the case of the binary tree, where in the isotropic case we had a nice union of intervals, and here it is a counterset from in the isotropic case. And the last corollary that I promised is that by considering the non-isotropic case for the Grigorchuk group, we can actually deduce that for the graphs associated to the same group, but with just three generators, which is the minimal case, the random walk will have the spectrum, which is a counterset of Rebecca measure zero. So for four generators, you have a union of intervals. When you go to the three generators, this changes drastically. So this is an example of non-stability of spectrum with respect to the change of the generating set. Thank you.